I would like first to apologize for being absent at the opening ceremony. The reason is that I didn't realize the meeting is going to take place here, and we went all the way with my favorite student to Koç University down to Sarıyer. It took us quite a time to go back and forth. However, I missed very much the beauty of my own country because I'm just coming back from America. I had the pleasure to be present at the graduation of my grandson and also to be able to celebrate Father's Day with my son. And so I apologize for whatever will be maybe not complete because I still have the jet lag. So may I greet everybody present here. Once more, submit my apologies. And I would like to greet a very old colleague of mine, Ayhan Kaya. He's one of the, how shall I say, leaders of indicating that to discuss simply citizenship in legal terms is not enough. And one has to look at the matter of changing countries from very different perspectives, and particularly from the point of view of sociology and anthropology. Now, I also think it's very meaningful that this program has been initiated by Dutch authorities, because many of you don't know, certainly. My basic career, that is, I'm now 93 years old, and I retired from my university due to the age limit according to Turkish laws at the age of 67. And until that age, I was based in Ankara, and the School of Political Science in Ankara has been the vanguard of first teaching political science. In that institute, I mean, in that faculty, in that school, we had an institute for urban and urban studies. And in the early 70s, a professor from Holland came to us and wanted to carry out a joint project. This project has been realized. It involved the participation of three Dutch professors and as many Turkish participants. They choose as a place to investigate the impact of migration on the left behind, on the other side, to study the input of savings of migrants in the home country. And the place which was chosen was the district of Boazlian in Yozgat. And this study lasted a whole year. It has been, the result has been published both in Turkish and in English. It's called Migration and Development, Göç ve Gelişme. And I have been the together with Professor Ruşen Kilaş, the two major investigators. So the interest of the Netherlands to migration is not new. It goes back, and there is this these proofs and this the findings, which are very interesting because so much has changed since this study was done. It was published in 1986, and but on the other side, I also have published myself at Brill, E.G. Brill in Holland, a book called Turks in Europe, which was published in 1976. So I have somehow close links with the Netherlands. And I think this is not a coincidence. I think it is because Holland, being a former colonial power after World War II, was obliged to reset its relationship with the former colonies, at the same time also giving the opportunity for those who wanted to move from Indonesia or other places, Dutch colonies, to the main country. And this transfer has occurred under the heading of in the framework of the Dutch legislation, which at the time was based on multiculturalism. The Netherlands is the only country in Europe which has a governmental policy, had a document called the minority rights, and so multiculturalism was the instrument for this government policy. It was drafted very carefully, and one of the participants of the Yozgat project later continued to work on this policy. He is now in Amsterdam. So the Netherlands is the only European country which totally changed its outlook to migration from the acceptance of governmental multicultural policy to a very different outlook, which is based with the perspective of integrating the migrants and no more permit them without depriving them from their legal rights. The legal rights are, as yesterday, also given today. So migrants who are coming to the Netherlands after 5 years of residence are eligible for Dutch nationality, and in the economic sphere and other places, they are totally placed on an equal level. But of course, the outlook of the governmental policy is very different. And it did not occur after the tragic events, two tragic events. One is the assassination of two personalities well known in the Dutch public opinion, one being 14, the leader of a rightist political party, and the other one being the grandson of Van Gogh. These two incidents, of course, provoked a deep shock, and a legitimate shock, but it produced a very different outlook to migration. And therefore, we could speak of the great fear of invasion of a culture which is not basically rooted in the Dutch society. I also want to underline that the Netherlands has a special character, and that is in the past, its liberal outlook. Let's not forget that writers, thinkers, philosophers who were persecuted in Europe because of their ideas could find refuge in the Netherlands. Among others, Erasmus is also one of them. And I think this to name the exchange program with Europe as Erasmus is extremely well chosen, and I like it very much. I also have to say that after I had to retire in Ankara, I decided to come to Istanbul because for me, among other human rights, there is also the right to look to the sea. I love the sea. So I lived for 45 years on the steppe. I said, this is enough. I served there. Now let me look at the sea. Take a cup of tea and look at the water. It's enough. And so I moved here. And at the time when I moved here, one of my students was the chair of the political science department in Boğaziçi University. And he said to me, please come as a part-time person and come and teach. So I grabbed the opportunity. And here's a young lady sitting in the in front. And she was a student of mine in Boğaziçi at 94. In 1994. Now, a few months ago, at Boğaziçi, they celebrated my 60th anniversary of teaching. And I love to teach. I must say, there is one passion. Everybody has one passion in life. My passion is to teach. I don't know to do anything else. I have here another very, very favorite student of mine, who, among other things, being an A student, she also has three children and some other jobs to do. That's what I like. Now, the Erasmus program brings a lot of European students. And in the last 6 or 7 years, after my hearing deteriorated and I can't anymore teach in large classes because I cannot answer the questions from the back, I now take only graduate students. And among the graduate students, I have each semester maybe to the utmost 3 Turkish students. That will be the maximum. The rest are all Europeans. And every semester I have at least 2 or 3 from America. So far I didn't have anybody from New Zealand, but I had also some people from Australia. So in other words, the Netherlands is very individualistic, an individualistic country, which attach great importance to personal freedom. At the same time, able to show sufficient tolerance to certain cultural values. And as I say, in political science, the concept of polarization, which is the most typical characteristics of the Netherlands, is the translation of this tolerance. Because polarization means that society is divided up in different groups. These groups may be Catholic, Protestant, secular, or Muslim, and as long as the polarization policy was applied, it meant that every pillar was organized in itself. In other words, if you are Catholic, you go to the Catholic Church, you go to a Catholic trade union, you go to a Catholic employment, and so on, and you have a Catholic media. So these are particularities of the Netherlands, which are not so well known, or first of all, are not accepted by other European countries. And therefore it occupies a rather special place in the European context. Now, what happened in this very specific, definable country is that suddenly, towards the the 90s, the late 90s, you have the invasion of a great technological innovation, and that's the intrusion of the internet. Now, the intrusion of the internet is not a simple fact. It's not only Facebook, Twitter, I don't know what. It is a complete different world system, because from that period on, the conventional media is pushed aside. It's not only political pressure which is suppressing certain media, it's also technology. The greatest newspapers of the world, like the New York Times, Le Monde, London Times, even these newspapers are afraid to be threatened and fighting for their survival. So we are living in a new world, and this new world is the world, I call it the post-Gutenberg galaxy. I say post-Gutenberg galaxy because a Canadian political scientist called McClellan, he was developing a thesis saying that before the printing press came, the world was informed in a different way, and a public opinion was formed differently. After the printing press came, Gutenberg enabled the printing of the Bible. From that moment on, the world is changing, because everybody now is able to read the Bible, and not only the Bible, but everything else which is published as books. So he called this the Gutenberg galaxy. And this Gutenberg galaxy lasted, according to me, and this is very personal, until the advent of the internet. With the internet coming, everything is changing. And therefore, let's look at the impact of this big change in terms of migration. It's very, very important, because those of you who have worked on migration know that in the late 19th century, when the big migratory waves were going within Europe and from Europe to America, so overseas, at the time of these migration, the migration were studied first by geographers, because geographers wanted to find out what happens if you cover so much distance or so much distance. So Ravenstein is, so to speak, the father of a theory on migration. And then in consequences, it's first the sociologist and then the anthropologist who began to study, and from there on the economist, and going on political scientist, and then comes the international relationist. And now, who is studying migration? The top of all the states. I mean, Obama is occupied with migration, Holland is occupied, Frau Merkel is occupied, and of course, our prime minister is also occupied, because migration became the number one of the political agenda. And the last European elections have shown that this is the big issue. And therefore, when I see in the newspaper that Monsieur Hollande has said to Mr. Erdogan, we are going to do our best in order to change the approach to Turkey's European membership, I had to smile a little bit, because we know very well that in France and in Netherlands, you have to have a referendum in order to be accepted. And to overcome the animosity of the European member states against new members will not be easy. And therefore, we have to study as much as possible to see what are the consequences of this big migration, the migratory invasion, and also to see what the young generation is thinking about this situation. And in order to give an answer, I wanted to take one concept, and that's the concept of integration. As you know, the magic word of all these discussion is integration. Everybody would like to integrate the newcomers. Now, if you take a definition of encyclopedia, if you take the English one of the English encyclopedia, it says integration is bringing together two different things, or when people become part of a group or society and are accepted, third one definition is a process of people of different races, to live and work together instead of segregation. Of course, here the word segregation is used because in the past, in all the colonies of Great Britain, or perhaps not all of them, but many of them, segregation was the major line. I mean, if we think of South Africa, in South Africa, apartheid was the government policy. So you have this kind of definition. Now, if you take the Oxford Encyclopedia, the Oxford Encyclopedia says integration is intermixing of people who are previously segregated or a process of people to teach them to live together. Now, these are concepts of integration. Of course, when you look into the major publications, you see that the word integration is what they call in English euphemism. In reality, it means assimilation or rejection. That's the Ishin Ruhu. That's the spirit of the word. And of course, all the European countries would like to interpret integration equal to assimilation. But of course, they cannot do it because it would imply to force them, force people to do something. And we are no more in this world. This world is no more permitting, obliged people to do something. Therefore, even Fukuyama has taken back his statement. Fukuyama is a Japanese scientist living in America. After the Berlin Wall collapsed, he wrote a book, rather provocative, and the name of the book is The End of History. What Fukuyama was saying at the time, that's in 1990, he was saying history came to an end because there is no other solution for all the societies in the world. All of them have to become democracies, and they are going to become democracies. So over time, there will be no history, because if history is relating conflicts, history will come to an end and we will have a peaceful world. Now, Fukuyama published a new book. And in this new book, he's very sincere. He said, I was wrong. I was wrong. It's not going to be that way. It's not going to be so easy. Everybody will not be able to achieve this goal of democracy. And therefore, we will have major conflicts. And these major conflicts, of course, are occurring in those societies where there are new groups coming in. And therefore, we have to look what has been the role of this integration process, which in reality is not really integration process, on the new generations. The new generations of minority groups in different countries. Now, these different countries are in Europe as well as elsewhere. When we look a little bit more careful, we see that there are some great problems with the problems of identity. Identity, again, is one of those words which forces you to think two ways. Identity, you can ask, when you go to a bank in Turkey, the first thing the teller will ask you, kimlik kartınız nerede? Where is your identity card? Everybody has to carry an identity card. And the identity card, of course, is indicating whether I am a Turkish subject, what gender I belong, etc., etc. And it also means that I am a Turkish citizen. And by doing so, the others who are not Turkish citizens are the others. And once you have others in a society, then of course you have, you have the confrontation of two groups. But identity is not only that. Identity is something else. And many, many European countries, also I think the Netherlands, are nourishing the concept that if you give citizenship to a given group, in the Netherlands, the majority of the Turkish population there, I think right now the Turkish population in the Netherlands is around 380,000, something like that. That by doing that, they automatically become Dutch. I mean, they become Dutch citizen, but they are also member of the Dutch society. In reality, they are not. The reality, because identity is not only the legal document, it's something else. And when you ask it, then you will get very surprising answers. The Dutch law are also giving the permission to have a dual citizenship. I am a Dutch citizen. I live in Amsterdam or I live in Rotterdam, but my heart, I have also my relatives at home, and partly of my heart is over there. Now, Professor Kaya has very beautifully studied the, the identity, this double identity of migrants. You ask them, who are you? And he answers, this was in the case of Germany. Most of the second largest group of, after Turkey, the city which has the greatest amount of Turkish citizens is Berlin, the capital of Germany. In Berlin, there are, I think, around over 200,000 Turks alone in Berlin. And there is a district called Kreuzberg. And in Kreuzberg, you can be as well in Aksaray or in Kreuzberg. It's more or less the same thing. Now you ask this young man, where are you, where do you belong? He says, my identity is I'm a Kreuzberg guy. I don't belong to Berlin, I don't belong to Brandenburg, I don't belong to Federal Germany, I don't belong to the European Union. I am from Kreuzberg, but I'm also from Kadıköy. And Kadıköy, but not any other part of Istanbul, because in Kadıköy, there are my friends who are singing the same songs as me. And so I have two identities, but they go together. I mean, why should I push one away or the other? I have the two together. Now, the best example of this was 2 days ago. I promised my close friends that I will attend their wedding, the wedding of their daughters. And the wedding took place on Saturday night. And they had planned this wedding for years. And unfortunately, it was raining. It was a beautiful wedding. All of us had umbrellas. But at the end, towards in the advancing hours of the evening, a jazz band came. And what do I see? The bride taking the microphone. I mean, she lives in Philadelphia. She has not lived in Turkey for at least 8 or 10 years. She works in Philadelphia. The bridegroom also works in Philadelphia. So they are Turkish-American citizens. And she sings, but what is she singing? All the pop songs in Turkish. I mean, you couldn't imagine a better artist than the bride. I have pictures. She was wonderful. Everybody applauded her. They thought that somebody's coming from outside. No, it was the bride herself. And the husband was playing the guitar. And it was a wonderful. And that is exactly what I mean by hybrid identity. This is hybrid identity. And for heaven's sake, let the European government realize that this is a de facto situation. You cannot change it anymore. You cannot change the anima of the person. This is their psychological inclination. They want to belong to more places because they think the world is beautiful. And when my grandson graduated, and there was an allocation by his classmate, he said, we are the new generation of the 21st century. We believe in YOLO. What is YOLO? Y-O-L-O. You only live once. You only live once. So YOLO, for these young people, this is YOLO. And YOLO means to take what you like and make a combination. Now, I have a paper which was referred to me from a publisher for review, and I don't know the author. And it's about second, third generation Canadian Turkish youth. Now, I want to quote here some remarks of the interviewed people. And let me see. About identity. Mehmet. I am not confused about my identity because I am 100% Turkish. Immigrating to a country and feeling I belong are very difficult. My parents' decision to immigrate was to have better opportunities, but not to become a Canadian. I would continue my life here as a Turkish person. That's one. Now, another one, Ahmed. To live in Canada, I didn't distance myself from Turkishness. While I'm listening to the Turkish anthem, I still get goosebumps, gumbumps. That's weird. I mean, how can I still have this feeling? Maybe it is in my blood. I was very young. I don't remember anything. Maybe because my father was telling me stories about Atatürk. They have been asking me who my role model is since primary school. Atatürk is my first and foremost role model. He's my unknown first role model. Now, another person, Kaya. This is not this Kaya. Both of them, Turkey and Canada, are two different worlds. Here my friends call me Turk. To Turkey they call me Canadian. I always feel myself in between. You live like a Canadian here and you miss Turkey. When I'm coming back from Turkey, I don't feel I belong to Canada. When I come back to Canada, I feel I came to a foreign country again. But when I'm in Turkey, I think, oh, I'm really part of Canada, and I'm really proud of being Canadian in Turkey. I think this is stuck in between. I feel handicapped. I feel like I'm caught in between. Now, ML is a girl. When I was 18, I remembered everything I was when I was 7. I still knew my ways around the street. I still remember how to go to my aunt's home. The streets and everything I knew, where the coffee shop was, I knew when the bakkal was. It is a huge city here, and it's a couple of days. Still, I knew how to get from my aunt's house. You still have that memory, and you still hold those things. Then comes Aisha. Aisha says, it is kind of different in Canada. When they ask where I am coming from, I say Turkish. But I'm in Turkey, I say I'm Canadian. Because in Canada, you don't see so much Turkish people. So I'm like, I'm Turkish. It's like a cool country for some people. But I am in Turkey, I'm just like you, I am Canadian, because they are like, no, they are like, no, you are Turkish because your mom is Turkish. I'm like me, I was born in Canada, I'm Canadian. So here you see these young people, what they are doing is they are negotiating, reshaping, and redefining their identity. And many times they redefine also their religious identities. Consequently, they create their own religion. Again, Professor Kaya, in his, he has a very good book. I recommend it to everybody. What does it say? Securitization of migrants. It's a recent book. I think it's very good. Leila, when I say I'm Muslim, they are like, what do you mean? No, you are not. Yes, I am Muslim, Turkish. People are Muslim. So it's a kind of shock to them. And they are like, you don't wear hijab or headscarf. And I'm like, do I have to be a Muslim? That's my choice. As someone who is a Muslim, I want to wear what I want to wear. So you see, I mean, the person is not denying it's religious belief, but at the same time, he is choosing his own criteria, And another one, the same, it's, I should know, it's somebody else. It's Leila. I really like live music. I like rock a lot. I like to go to concerts. But I don't know, I've never had nightlife like Canadian students have done. I think because I'm really religious. So this girl loves to go to jazz concerts, but after that, she's not hanging around with the boys. Instead of that, she goes home. The conclusion is that what we have here is not only hybridity, but super hybridity, because the values and the values, the definition of what values the person is decided to accept is personal. It's not the group. The group is not imposing anymore. So the consequences is that the European, most of the European governments are standardizing minority groups. And they think that everybody can be put in this one box. And this is the major error. I think an unforgivable error. This is, I cannot accept this. Because if you cannot equate fanatic Orthodox Muslim, for instance, with a Bosnian Muslim. There are a world between them, and you cannot at the same time equate other religious communities to put them on the same level. An Indian person will be very different. There will be great differences between those who are working in a very high positions versus somebody who performs a job of minor importance in Europe. These also are not the one type of Hindu. There are I don't know how many type of Hindu. The same applies for the Jews also. I mean, to think that everybody is like Hamas is wrong, because in New York, there are those who on Friday afternoon have a bus taking them to a suburb where they are not opening even the gas. I mean, it's Sabbath. They are celebrating it until Saturday evening. But the majority of the Jewish population in New York is as secular as one can imagine. And they also don't deny of being Jewish. So for heaven's sake, let's forget about standardization of religious identity. This is the number one issue which I would like to convey to anybody who has to do something with European migration questions. This is absolutely necessary. And therefore, I blame very much Germany. I'm talking a lot about Germany because that's one of the reasons is that German is my mother tongue. I mean, I am the daughter of a German mother and a Turkish father, but I lost my parents very early. I grew up in Izmir, but I still have my maternal language sufficiently developed that I taught a lot of in a number of German universities and also American universities. At the beginning of my studies in migration, the German statistics were indicating for each city legal identity of the migrants. In other words, it was last cited as Turkish, Greek, Italian, Spanish, Greek, etc. Now there is no more. What do they have now? Muslims. One category. I mean, how can you study one category if you only have a single name, Muslim? That's impossible, because you can't differentiate about. First of all, Turkey legally and according its constitution is a secular republic. All the other Muslim countries are applying the Shariat. According to Shariat, you cannot perform certain things. Some of you certainly are aware that the Constitutional Court of Turkey has cancelled all the verdicts pronounced about some criminal cases in the past. So a great number of people who were in jail, but the sentence was not pronounced, have been freed. If you want to find out how did this happen, I have to tell you that these cases have been taken by the application of three different courts in Turkey. Three different courts appealed to the Constitutional Court and say that this imprisonment is wrong because it is not compatible with the Constitution. Each of these courts were headed by a woman judge. And if this would have happened in any other country out of Turkey, it would have been impossible, because according to Shariat, a woman can never become judge. The profession of becoming judge is impossible, because as the judge, judge can only be men, and men can only be those person qualified to interpret the Quran. So, I mean, it's not possible to study these problems if you put them in one single box. You have to acknowledge that this is a new world. And by saying so, I spoke too much. Elderly people are speaking a lot, and I am also one of them. I thank you for your attention. I hope that I satisfied some of the demands of the organizing committee, because as you see, whether in Canada or in Europe or wherever else, or in Australia, the new generation wants to be a generation where the permission of negotiating their identity is given. And therefore, multiculturalism, according me, is wrong. So much. Thank you.